We thank you for your faithfulness, for your love and your mercy, your tender kindness and even your favor. We thank you, God, for your chastisement, for the word informs us that you chastise those in whom you love. God, we've come today to worship, magnify, and praise you, to lift one another up. God, now we come down to preaching time. And so we ask you, God, that you would prepare us to hear from heaven. Open our spiritual eyes, God, that we can see past the natural into the spiritual realm. God, unclog our natural ears that we might be able to hear in the spirit what it is that you're saying to the church and to each one of us on today. Now, God, allow me to decrease as the Holy Spirit increases. Let the very words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, God, who art my strength and my redeemer. For it's in the blessed name of Jesus the Christ I pray and I thank you. Amen.
Amen.
From the passage read in our scripture hearing, this epistle, this letter of appreciation written to the church at Philippi in thanks of the gifts, financial gifts, that they had sent to Paul while he was under arrest in the Roman jail under Nero. He writes, and I want to pay attention to verses 12 through 14. We continue our series on teaching until we have better attendance at Bible study.
Amen.
And by the way, we had an outstanding Bible study on this past Wednesday.
Amen.
You should have been there.
Well,
I don't know if I told you last week, but from time to time we have little special things. We've had candy, we've had gifts, we've had a little pizza party at Bible study. You never know what might happen, right, Sister Lucille, at Bible study.
Amen.
Verse 12 says, not that I have already obtained. In other words, comprehended or understood, or am already perfected. Mm. When we think of perfections, we think of something that has no flaws. Paul here is talking about having reached his ultimate goal in Christ. But I press on, the neighbor say, press on, that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has already or also laid hold of me. Brother, I do not count myself too apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Where are you now?
Where are you now?
I'd like to speak to you this morning from this question. Where are you now? If not you, perhaps you know of someone who was a sports star during their high school or some prestigious award at some point and time in the life. Perhaps you know someone that has a I love you wall or a trophy wall, and they're lined up on the shelves or across the wall are awards and trophies that they've received for various things. These people are quick to tell you of what they used to be and what they have accomplished in the past. What it is as well as the vocation for which he had stood. A man that the most of his dedication for, he declared that as much as he went after those that served Christ before he was converted, that he would help to convert those that did not know Christ. And a man that could boast of his separation for, among other things, a man who could say that God has set me aside for what he has called me to. That he confesses that he really doesn't know what God has planned for his life. He doesn't know the fullness of his purpose. Think about it. What Paul is saying and how it relates to you and me today. My brothers and my sisters, while we live in a time that many Christians are blessed and highly favored, chosen and appointed, sanctified and set aside, Paul in fact says that no matter what God has done to you, through you, or for you, you still don't have any idea of what you will be when God is through with you. Look at the neighbor, say, neighbor. Where are you now?
Where are you now?
Hosanna, this is a humbling statement. Let me be honest. Let us be honest with ourselves. We live in a time that we want to have a sense of accomplishment. Almost everybody wants to be a part of a successful movement. Most of us want to reach certain financial goals and positions in our life. But when we have fasted, when we have prayed, studied, and meditated on the Word of God, we want to think of ourselves as Christians that have grown from milk to meat. We would like to think of ourselves as being mature Christians and not babies. We mentally separate ourselves from others that are less devoted, less educated, less overrated than we are, less informed as we are. How easy it is for us to get swallowed up in titles and positions. But I believe that it was Paul that instructed the church of Romans in saying, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. But to think soberly according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith."
Well,
look at your neighbor, say, neighbor. He was talking about me. My brothers and my sisters, no matter what our perception is of ourselves, and let me pause to say, most of us want to think of ourselves in a high manner. Nobody wants to think of themselves in a low state. But no matter what we think of ourselves, none of us know what God has in store for us. None of us can predict his or her future. None of us know the day that God will call us home and call us to his judgment seat.
Yes.
And none of us know what path we have to travel in order to get there.
Well,
you can look back and see where you came from. And while we want to get to that cross, that river of joy, we have no idea what path God is going to take us on in order to get